I'm excited to be talking today with Gregory Alan Isakov, who is in a break from the road. And I think most of your life is currently touring, is it not? Except for a day or two stolen at home in Colorado?
Yeah, you know, most of the winters, it's been kind of like the schedule lately because I run a small farm and just outside of Boulder, Colorado. So I mostly work during the summers, you know. We'll do some festivals, but not very many.
I was wondering how the farm works when you are on the road. Is that how you choose that season?
Yeah, there's a bunch of us who live out there, so we always kind of swap turns out of town. The last couple of months I've been out of town, yeah.
You have a brand new album. It's called Weatherman, and there's not really a song on the playlist called Weatherman. But
no, yeah.
Is that a line, or is it just an idea that you chose that for?
It sort of happened kind of organically. I was writing a series of short stories called The Weatherman at the same time that I was making the record. A lot of the lines kind of made it into the record, and a lot of the ideas, and, you know, a lot of the subject matter was sort of just about these everyday things that you kind of maybe skip in your perception or you don't notice as much. And these kind of very normal, mundane things, and bringing light to these, finding like magic in them.
You know, you have a very distinctive sense of, I guess I'd say a sense of art, not only in your music, what I hear reflected, but if I look on your website too, there's this look, there's this something nostalgic from the past. Is that how you'd describe that?
Yeah, maybe so, yeah. I don't know why we're attracted to the things that we like. I don't know what that is. But yeah, I think our aesthetics make it into every part of our life.
I saw a response to a photo that you had posted. It was you in an old, what we'd almost called an immigrant's cap. And they said, what century do you live in anyway? And I wonder, do you ever feel like out of sorts with the modern world?
I always do, yeah. I think I always have had that kind of feeling, especially where I live. It's sort of a more rural setting, but I'm pretty psyched to live right now. I like getting avocados in the winter. And there's some cool things about our modern-day world.
I'd have to agree about that.
Yeah.
Let me ask about songwriting for you. Is that something you set time aside for, like, okay, it's 9 o'clock, it's time to write a song, I'm going to work on it every day? Or are you looking for an idea or a feeling first, and that's how it comes?
Well, I have a writing practice, you know, and it's not necessarily songwriting. It's sort of this kind of boundaryless, you know, mostly prose and short stories and poems, which I usually do wake up in the morning and do that, yeah. When I'm working on a piece of music, sometimes, you know, a line from the writing will make it in there, and sometimes it doesn't, but I think the muscle is kind of, the craft of punching in that kind of going to work thing is really important. I don't know if it would be as efficient without it.
At some point, these writings turned into songs, and then you must have shared them with somebody because people wanted to hear them. And what made you decide, maybe I should record these, maybe I need to go around and tour with these?
I don't know. You know, that's a funny question because I think I've always been attracted to just making records. You know, I never thought I would get to tour or get to do this for a living or at all. I was a horticulture major through college and worked on a bunch of farms and sort of just had a landscaping company, kind of just me, like one man show. I think I've always treated music like it's part of my day, like kind of eating dinner, or it was a thing I did after work. And making records is something I love, you know, the entire thing, like the whole piece of music, you know, song after song after song. And some records just speak as a whole piece of work. And so I've always just wanted to make records like that, and I'm always striving for that.
Well, you've assembled a band, and as we were setting up, I said, is there a name for your band? And what did you say?
I said, the guys I pay.
Okay, the guys I pay to play. But how did you assemble that crew?
Well, we're all best friends. You know, we all kind of met in the music scene in Denver and Boulder, and we've always been playing together. And, you know, whether it's just bar gigs or touring or, you know, in my kitchen, we all sort of grew up playing music together.
People always predict the demise of live music because music is so available, so downloadable. But as you tour around, and you really do tour around the whole country, just looking recently, you're all over the West from Colorado to California. I see that your Salt Lake City show is sold out, although just a few tickets left for Park City for anybody who's listening. But do you see that? Is it harder to get audiences, or do people still just really connect with live?
I think that people really do love live music. I love connecting that way as well. You know, I never thought I would because it never came naturally to me. You know, it was always something I always used to get extremely nervous about, pace back and forth before every show. And that never really went away, but I'm like more cool with it now, you know. I'm more cool with that kind of energy. But there's something that I get out of it that it's almost ineffable. I don't really know.
Well, I can tell from your website that you care about your lyrics because they're all easily accessible there. But you don't seem determined really to tie up every loose end. How would you describe your writing?
That's sort of a goal of mine, to try to, when I switch over into the listener part of myself, I want to be able to create the story along with the piece of music as well. So it's like this subtle balance of trying to tell a story and also leave it open, which I think, you know, that's what I need out of music when I listen to it. We're all just trying to make something useful, you know, to people. And music is just one of those things that's just so personal and it's so important.
The technical term I could use was you have a very strong aesthetic sense, but that sounds sort of dry. I could also say it's pretty cool. Maybe what you said is best, that it's personal. It's something that's distinctively you. I really hear that from what you do.
Thank you. Yeah. You know, writing is sort of mysterious thing. I always feel like I'm co-creating this piece of music. You know, I start out with like a seed of some kind, and then I'm sort of like, I hope you finish this week or this year, but I'm sort of having this conversation with it until it's finished. You know, I always really looked up to writers, you know, like Leonard Cohen, Springsteen, and Dylan, and some of these writers just tell these amazing stories, you know. They're like little short films in 2 or 3 minutes. That's never really been my style. That never came naturally to me. So for me, I've noticed my writing style is a lot more, you know, one line will be from a bird's eye view, and then maybe the next line will be from underneath the ground or in a different place or a different time on that situation. But that just seems like the way that it naturally comes.
Gregory Alan Isakov, touring singer-songwriter and occasional farmer. You can find out where he is by checking him out on Facebook or his website, Gregory Alan Isakov. That's Alan, A-L-A-N, and Isakov, I-S-A-K-O-V.com. We wish you luck with your upcoming touring and this new album, The Weatherman.
Thank you so much.